Welcome back to the Brazilian BA guest. Today, I have the honor to receive again a guy who is making the connection between agile and business analysis and helping a lot of companies to understand better how to do better business analysis and agile in the same context. And this guy is Howard Podeswa. Hello, Howard.
Hi, everybody.
I'm happy you're here.
Nice to see you again. It's been a long time.
Yes. And at the last time you were here, Howard, you were answering me the question, how do I ensure that a story is ready for development? And you gave us four options to make that decision. And one of them was the definition of ready. You spoke about spikes. You spoke about the future preview meetings. And you also wanted to talk about ATDD. And I interrupted you because the episode was becoming longer. And someone complained to me online on YouTube and said, oh, you didn't let the guy to explain how ATDD works and why it's important. So the question for you today, and we have a single episode for that, is what is ATDD? Let's add also another soup of letters, BDD. Right. And why should I care as an agile business analyst?
All right. So first of all, thanks for having me back. And also thanks to that listener for asking that question, because it kind of bugged me too that we never got around to that. And that's kind of an important one. So also my apologies for blabbing on about other things. So let's get right to it so we don't lose our time today. ATDD stands for, I keep wanting to say attention deficit disorder. Of course, it's not that. It's acceptance test-driven development. And BDD stands for behavior-driven development. I often put those two things together because there's a huge overlap between the two concepts. And what's really important is basically the practice that, you know, that comes out of it. Just quickly, historically, ATDD is an extension of TDD, test-driven development. Test-driven development was all about unit testing, and ATDD takes this idea and says, let's not talk about the unit of code in terms of testing that. Let's pull it up a notch to a little bit higher. Let's talk about testing requirements units. In other words, testing user stories or features. Let's take it up to that level. And so that's what ATDD is all about. So behavior-driven development was developed by Dan North in the early 2000s, and so it's related to all of this. So let's talk about what the main ideas are. Now we have the acronyms. If we can distill it down to this. Number one, specify acceptance criteria before you code your features. That's sort of rule number one of ATDD.
What do you call an acceptance criteria? Can you?
All right, yes. So let me give you an example. That's the easiest way to explain it. Suppose I have a feature that says, this is a real one from one of my clients. As a planner, I want to enable drop ship product identification in assortment planning so that I can increase sales without the associated inventory expense. So that's a classic user story. It's what I want to do and why I want to do it. So in order to, how do we know that the developers have actually developed what it is, you know, enough that it's actually deliverable from the customer's point of view? Well, we do that with following this approach by writing acceptance criteria. In other words, these are the conditions that must be satisfied before that user story will be accepted. And the idea of ATDD is that you write those acceptance criteria beforehand. So an example of an acceptance criteria could be a successful test, a successful scenario. I can identify a dropship eligible product would be the way we might say that just in, you know, a regular conversation. That's actually the way we describe the scenario. The BA would write that. And then in the more formal way, we might write, given that I am signed in as person X, when I query product ID equals SKU 503, then I should see the product is dropship eligible. In other words, we actually describe the test case and what the results of the test case would be, and we can do a number of scenarios like these. So that's basically the idea. The idea is quite simply is that the business analyst should make sure that those types of requirements, those acceptance criteria, are written before anyone starts to actually develop code. That's the basic idea.
And when you explain this more formal way, there's a language for that. I see that used some keywords, right?
Yeah, thank you for bringing that up. So with ATDD, the important thing is actually to have, is when you write these acceptance criteria and that you do it through a collaboration between the central players. And these players are the analyst who is leading that conversation, the customer represented by the product owner or subject matter experts in their place, QA, which represents testing, and then you have development, who knows the cost of what you're asking for. So that's the most important thing. But most commonly, it's done in a language referred to as Gherkin, and the automated testing tool that wraps around that whole thing is called Cucumber. And in fact, when BDD was first actually invented by Dan North, it was tied together with that language. He sort of realized the idea behind it and the language sort of at the same time. But he basically, his brilliant flashpoint was to say, when I write these test cases and I write them in this language, which looks a lot like English, what I'm actually writing is requirements. These test cases are the requirements. And that's sort of the brainstorm that's behind this concept. So that's the most important idea, or I would say that's the central idea, but there's just a couple of other practices that are related to it. Another is that it's more useful to write these requirements / tests using specific scenarios. That's more meaningful because it tends to flesh out the requirements a lot better. The other idea behind it is that if you do use a structured language to write this, then you basically have one language that goes all the way through from business and permeates all the way down into the code, which is a great thing. So it avoids any kind of misunderstandings.
Everybody speaks the same language. That's
exactly
good.
And the idea is to do this in an incremental manner through these conversations between these players that I just described, which we sometimes refer to as the triad. And then finally, is that you don't try to determine what all the acceptance criteria are up front and analyze them. Instead, you try to focus on the high value ones first and get them down, and then have somebody actually, and then have the developers code it, and then move on to the next criteria, code that, and so on and so on. It's really an extension of the idea of the way TDD was done, except at this requirements level. So those are the concepts behind it, and that's an example we've kind of gone through as well.
Just to make it clear, if you're writing the acceptance criteria for some user story, you should write those criteria just before developing it. So if you have a Scrum methodology and you're developing in sprints, you should wait for your story enter to the next sprint, and that's the time for defining those criteria. Is that correct?
That's correct. I mean, that's right. The basic idea is that for the most part, if a story is going to enter a sprint, then you should have an acceptance criteria written for that story before coding begins. It's great if you have at least a high level version of it before the actual sprint planning meeting itself, because it helps you, amongst other things, it helps you get a better estimate. Because it gives you better understanding. Everybody understands what's really being talked about here. But the other thing is, too, that if you do the acceptance criteria and you write them before developers start, it means that developers have real guidance, right, about what it is they have to write. If you write these acceptance criteria thinking that, they're really just all about testing, and you do that after the fact, first of all, they often don't get written, and the automated test cases themselves don't get written because the implementation was already done. But secondly, you've lost your chance to actually have those guide the developers in the first place. So much more effective to actually do it, right from the very, very beginning. And then of course, the other thing is that if you do that, it means that you can rely now on that documentation, because the documentation was written before the development actually even started. So, the big problem that we often have is that we don't rely on documentation even when we have it. Here, you know that you have a steady stream of reliable, usable information. But I think the most important thing is also the approach itself, which is to focus on the high-value acceptance criteria first and try to get those out instead of trying to boil the ocean and get the entire feature out. And so this basically gives us a tool to focus on high value so that we can deliver something that is the most important to the customer and deliver that quickly.
And I like it very, much the approach that you mentioned, that we can, we should make a join group with the developers, with the business analysts, with the testers, and try to realize those acceptance criteria together, because that, exactly, this is not a textual stuff. That's a way to understand and shared understand, create that's a right. shared understanding about the requirements. That's really powerful.
Yeah, that's right. It's, in other words, it's another way of thinking about it. Tests are not something that you write after the fact. They are something that you write at the beginning because they actually stand in for the requirements. I should say they don't represent all the requirements, but they are requirements in the sense that if you write acceptance criteria for a story and the story actually, you know, satisfies those acceptance criteria, it means it's behaving correctly. And if it doesn't satisfy them, it means it's not behaving correctly. So you're actually, what you have there are functional requirements for the story.
Nice. And all these techniques like ATDD, BDD, and the other ones you mentioned last in the last episode are available for the ones who wants to get it in more details in your book. Is that correct?
Yeah. So the book goes into ATDD in quite a bit of detail and BDD. And in fact, it's just a constant theme as well throughout the book. So we basically show how those ideas are used, what the BDD role is and all of that. On top of that, just for right now, I can just let people know that if you go to www.nobleinc.ca, so it's NOBLEINC.ca, and you go to free downloads, you'll actually find there that we have posted a downloadable template that has the major features of that BDD Gherkin language, including some actual examples that you can use. So you know, direct people to that if they want to see exactly how that goes.
Very nice. That's an opportunity. That's an opportunity. And you said you do have another indication for book, another suggestion to talk about BDD and
oh, that's right. Yeah. So aside from my own book, which by the way just arrived in the mail a few days ago, so I'm so happy about that.
That's really nice.
This book arrived a few weeks earlier. It's called, as you can see, it's well thumbed through by me already, Behavior Development, Driven Development with Cucumber. It's written by Richard Lawrence, who's one of the people who actually developed software for this in the first place. So a good first source. And I definitely recommend anybody who wants to dive into this particular topic, that's a great book for them to have a look at.
Howard, thank you again to be here with us. It was a great pleasure to have you. And thank you for sharing all those knowledge with BAs all around the world, especially here in Brazil.
Thanks, my pleasure. Thanks for having me back.
See you soon.
Till next time.